some type of educational space. That means in your church, pastor's getting your money. He's living pretty well. The lady in church living pretty well, dressed nice. That's great. We need an educational space. Not just Sunday school.
Right.
I'm not knocking it. It works for you, great. They need to learn things like how to cook healthy and nutritious meals.
Peace.
So they don't have to support the right things that they need. It's a shame. There's some kids who actually think that you need a McDonald's to get a hamburger. They actually don't know that. No, you can actually cook a hamburger right in your house. That has to be taught. Too many women, and I'm not sexist, and men are 20 and 30 and 40 can't cook a damn meal, man. Wasting money, wasting their resources, making the family die from hypertension and diabetes. So it's all connected. We need to make sure that we have this in our places of worship. Those places of worship have teachers and community advocates and activists and Afrocentric people. Get them involved and say, look, we need to start a Saturday school in our church. And we're going to be back in the morning, 2 hours, we're going to bring the kids. That's one side of the house. In the home, books like this, Amos Wilson, Developmental Psychology of the Black Child. How to Awaken the Genius in the Black Child. Amos Wilson, get those books. That empowers the parents to do this right in their home.
Right.
Proper discipline. How you discipline without humiliating and shaming and emasculating little boys and girls. Teaching boys and girls to think and to raise intelligent questions. Not giving them easy answers. Rewarding them for just demonstrating original thought. Wow. Tahiti? That was really an interesting question. What made you ask that? You know? The kid says, what makes hurricane? Whoa! Zakiya, that's beautiful. What made you ask that question? What? I don't know, but let's go and then show them how to find the answer. All of these things. The school, the home, the place of worship. In the school, we have parent associations. Every school is required to have one. And we do not take advantage of it. Yes, sir. We do not take advantage of it. We have to infiltrate those parent associations. Hear me well. We need to infiltrate those parent associations. We need to take them over. We need to demand that money is spent a certain way. We need to hold the school leadership team. We need to build a school leadership team. You have to take over all these sites of power. Now, while we are doing that, we will also have those of us homeschooling, building African-centered schools, so that in another 10 years, all our kids can go. But until that time, we gotta use what we have right now to our advantage. Now, I have three articles I brought here that y'all can get towards the end. One is called The Hidden Agenda Behind Educating Black and Brown Children, which lays it out, gives you the history of who gave us education, how they came up with that back in the 1900s or 1900s. Resolving the problem of black miseducation. And then the third one is rethinking the goals and methods of child education. So please, when we're done, feel free to take one. And thank you for your time. I've been talking a long time. I teach black people and organizations how to organize the community effectively. And I also teach people how to teach their kids, how to properly edify their kids, and how to advocate for them. Okay, so you're saying traditional K-12 schools versus independent black schools?
No. Independent black schools have K-12 in one school, in one setting, as opposed to elementary, middle, high school.
Well, to my knowledge, it doesn't exist. But, this is the crux of what I was getting to. This is the problem. To get that type of thing, you gotta pay money, a lot of people don't have. Do I think it's a good idea? I think it's a good idea for this reason. Because the white man calls it a cohort. So, you coming in first grade, 20 people. Y'all move to second grade. Shakria, how you doing? We all know each other. They moved to third grade, all the way to 12th grade. These people have been together since first grade. So it builds a bond and a trust and a sense of community. And that is really good. Some of the kids will leave, but basically I think that's an excellent idea. I just think we need to have the people who know about that to work with the community activists, to work with the educational scholars. See, that's what's missing. You can't just have community activists. They got the will, they're ready to go, but they don't know what to do. Well, what is it? You just can't be a teacher. Is that right? And then all you have the people with the money that are really smart, but they don't know what they're really doing. We need to have the philanthropists connect with the educational experts that are Afrocentric. To connect with the activists on the ground making it happen. That's what has to really happen. Yeah, yes, sir. That's
fair. Appreciate you.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you too.
Got you. Next guest.
Sister. Oh,
yes. Yeah, you said in the beginning that you were saying something about charter.
Oh, this will be very quick out of respect for the other guests coming up. Not all charter schools are bad. I'm gonna start there. And not all charter schools are good. But I have to tell you this. This I was discussing this in this article about miseducation. A lot of the charter schools are started by white conservative family foundations. So the Walmart Family Foundation, Sam Walmart created the store called Walmart and Sam's Club. He donates millions of dollars to Republican Party every year. And he's a racist. They underpaid workers, right? But he has like 7 different charter schools, all in black and brown areas. Carl Icahn, rich, he donated a stadium across from Rikers Island. You look at it, says Icahn. In the Bronx, he has 7 Icahn charter schools. He buys businesses and sells them for cheap profit. He's not a person who's demonstrated any love for us. So, it's telling you that a lot of them see it as business. Brother Q talked about the prison system, but people don't understand education is big business. People are creating charter schools and getting mad money from it, right? So, I had to resign from a school, a charter school, up in New Haven. I'll be quick, I'm just gonna end on this, Brother Q. What they were doing was, if this brother smacks her in the head in class, and I'm teaching, she says, stop. I tell her, I go, oh, I have a clipboard. I have 20 deductions. This is true. A clipboard with 20 deductions. So I got to go to her and say, you get a minor deduction for speaking out of turn. She goes, but he hit me in my head. I said, oh, you get another minor deduction for speaking out of turn. Why? Because all they allow them to say when a teacher says something to them is, I'm sorry. Okay, or can we talk about it later? If the kid doesn't say those 3 things, they get a deduction. And if they get 3 of those, they get a major deduction. And then what happens is they call the dean comes and gets her. Now she got hit in her head. She was simply saying, stop hitting my head. Nothing happens to him. Comes and gets her, takes her to a room all day where there's no instruction. Calls the parents. The next day, she has to wear a gray t-shirt to school. The rest of the kids wear a green polo. She comes with her gray shirt. She sits in the gray shirt corner. They have a whole separate place in the class. Those kids sit over here. They can't pass any materials. No kid in the school can speak to them. That ish is crazy. That's complete. That's crazy. That is education unsettled. So I had to resign from that school with a really nasty letter to them. But the point is, that's the type of things that's going on in some of these charter schools. Discipline that's like straight up like from a prison bullpen. These are the little kids. Or suspending fifth graders from school for chewing gum, rolling their eyes, sucking their teeth. This is not the way you discipline. So, all right, I'm sorry, y'all.
Can you introduce yourself again? Because I came in late. I don't know exactly
who. Oh, yes, sir. You know what I'm going to do for time? On these articles at the bottom is a brief private bio. I'm sorry, because I don't want the brothers and sisters to get mad at me. And I want to respect their time.
So he's not leaving yet. If you could take some pictures, please tag it. No. Link up. Tell everybody.
Yeah, I'm on Facebook. I'm on Twitter.
Thank you. So the next sister coming up. Again, one more time for the brother.
Role and its leadership, and I really should live up to everything that you nation. So I introduced myself. I was taking notes about my brother speaking. Well, we was talking about homeschooling and involvement in PTA.
First of all, that's the first thing we need to do. We're not engaged in our children.
It's okay.
We're not involved in the evolution of their mind. If we're not involved in the evolution of their mind, we're allowing somebody else to program them, and they're not living up to who they were supposed to be divinely. So the reason why I lean towards homeschooling and completely removing my
children. That was lovely. Thanks. Appreciate it.
He plugged in the computer. Oh,
wow. All right. Now, see, I lost my train, but I was doing good. Now but anyway, what I was saying was, the reason why I totally removed my daughter from public school was because every time she came home and I would ask her what she learned for today, it was always nothing or the same thing. So I took it upon myself to start investing in books, to start doing after-school curricular activities to help her stimulate her brain. But then progressing, I realized she's not learning anything. I said, what type of mother would I be to keep her in a place, in an institution that is not benefiting her or this nation? At first, I was scared because when you do it by yourself, it's far-fetched. You don't have the support of your family because they don't know nothing about homeschooling. They're pretty much indoctrinated and they discourage you from moving forth and liberating your child. So, like the brother said, it takes a village. Us in here, who's in here together and is going to be coming here frequently, we really need to build a strong bond, because like we were saying earlier, I don't allow my daughter just to affiliate with just any old body, even if we are supposed to be kinfolk. I don't know the mentality of that child, and I don't know the mentality of that parent. Our children are exposed to too many bad things at young ages. So for me to protect her innocence, I keep her away from people that I am not familiar with. So I try to lean towards brothers and sisters who are in the truth and the light, or as we say, conscious. And I like to affiliate myself with them, and also so she can have some socialism. That's the number one thing they try to beat into our heads when we move towards transitioning into homeschooling. They were like, well, what about the social aspect? First of all, when you go into sociology, you're just supposed to interact with another person. Your child is being social when they're talking to an intellectual and adult, which you are the parent. Your child socializes with you every day. You open up your book when you are teaching your child. Now, my special message goes out to the sisters on where is our maternal instinct, and where is that, and what is hindering and blocking us from listening to our intuition and our divine voice inside of us that's telling us that something's not right with these public schools, but yet we submit and continue to send our children into the lion's den. And that's one of the things that I was dealing with on a regular basis of sending her to school. It really made me depressed. I even used to cry walking her to school, but we used to say chants and songs, you know, just to lift my spirits up, because I hate bringing her somewhere knowing, because once you know, you can't deny truth and you can't push it away. It's going to keep eating at you. So, excuse me, I'm just trying to get everything in. African Center Homeschooling. Most people say, well, what is African Center Homeschooling? If you study our history, what we did, we was supreme mathematicians and scientists and holistic healers. So my curriculum is based on supreme mathematics and science. I buy books that are her quote-unquote grade level, but I want her to be advanced, because our children, we have to understand, we got to stop judging our child's intellect according to the European standard. How are we going to compare our children to people who just came out of the cave? That makes no sense. What I do is I go to Barnes & Noble, so if you go to any website, Amazon, eBay, I teach my daughter from college level. And the one thing with us, I feel a lot of brothers and sisters shy away from homeschooling because you're lazy. Because when you have to educate your child, you have to re-educate yourself. And then you don't realize how much you missed out on when you revisit elementary school. I realized my grammar was bad. I said, I got these little language arts books, and it help me to be better, to help me recall what I learned from my elementary school years, junior high school years. And also I can advocate from a standpoint of we all been at public school. A lot of us can sit here, honestly, I didn't learn nothing. I mastered how to cheat. I knew how to cheat. I'm telling you, if I would have had a phone, it would have been off the hook. But I used to have index cards flying out my fingers. I wrote answers on my hand because I was disengaged with the education because it didn't translate with me. But when I look back and remember the times that I had black teachers, it was something in me that woke me up, that felt I had to be on my best behavior, and I wanted to score high because I loved when the teachers gave me praise. When I had white teachers, I was a class clown. I didn't care. So genetically, it's a reason why our children need to see us in a position of authority that invokes something in them to say, I want to be the best that I can be. I want to please them. I want to show them that I'm doing my very best. When my daughter is at home, the one thing she said is that I challenge her at home. She says she felt elementary school is baby work, and it is because it's European. There are babies on the planet. Our children should come out the womb right into college.
Woo!
We build pyramids. What y'all talking about? 1 + 1, 2 + 2. We talk about geometry, trigonometry. And I'm not familiar with that because growing up, because I didn't have a good teacher that was able to educate me or open me up to mathematics, I always felt that I was bad. But if you're born perfectly healthy and you ain't have no cranial, no brain damage, there's nothing you can't learn. There's nothing that the original man cannot learn, because we have to understand, where does intellect come from? It comes from when you look in the mirror. Because if we are the divine image and reflection of the creator, of the supreme intelligence, we are intelligence walking each and every day, and that's why we're a target. This earth wouldn't be, this world wouldn't be modernized, quote unquote modernized. I don't even think it's modernized because ain't nobody building pyramids. But anyway, for argument's sake, technology or things wouldn't be advanced if it wasn't for the intervenience and the existence of the original man. So no matter if Steve Jobs or these other people of different races come up with advanced technology, or the Koreans or the Asians or whoever's leading, let them know who gave them the blueprint. And I tell my daughter every day, you're the original man, you're the original woman, you're the blueprint of humanity. But we don't teach our children who gave the world civilization, they don't have self-esteem. Education, absorbing knowledge, starts with a high self-esteem. Our children learn low self-esteem because when we send them to public school, what do they do? They learn about European victories. Amen. And that we started off as slaves. That we was in Africa swinging on trees like monkeys. So when we as parents don't intervene with our child's education, even if you cannot afford to homeschool, but that's still not an excuse. We need to start sitting down with our direct families. My sister just pulled her children out of school because she saw what I was doing with my daughter. We have to start sitting together to see how we can rotate and shift to educate our children. We're not going to be able tomorrow to build these institutions, our own privatized schools. But in the meantime, we have a home. We have a safe haven. See, the thing that I'm tired of with black people is we have excuses for everything. If you want this nation to rise, you don't want your child to fall victim to this system, then you take it in your hands. Especially the mothers out here. 80% of the household is ran by the woman, by the black woman. So for us to sit here, yeah, we all made mistakes and poor judgment and who we made it with, but now we have children. Now we have children. And when he was talking about building up numbers, I know a lot of sisters may not be comfortable with this, but we need to start bringing polygyny to the forefront. Because we can't just have any old man in front of our child. We gotta have the best man.
That's right.
I know you were like that, brother. I know sister. Polygyny should be definitely on the table because it's urgent that we have the best man in front of our children, raising our children. And funny enough, polygyny is not a patriarchal system. It's a matriarchal system. It's the divine mothers coming together under one umbrella for the welfare of the children, thus our nation. So trust me, I was reluctant when brothers brought it up because I didn't understand. But a lot of us are too selfish and we don't put our children first and say what's best for them and not what's best. Wasn't raised, or a lot of us grew up of not having fathers in our life. So therefore, we didn't know what to look for in a mate. We didn't know how to attract a man with our divine intellect. We reduced ourselves to our bodies. The best bodies on the planet, but we are beyond that. Because once you realize that you are the blueprint of humanity that birthed in the gods, there's no reason why your self-esteem should be low. It should be the highest thing. And when a black woman is on her job, you radiate and everybody gravitates towards you to compliment me. I have different races of people that just want to take pictures of me. Because that's how much I grow. And that energy of my high self-esteem comes and transcends to my child. Because she's an extension of me. She is my reincarnation. We gotta look at our children that there is our second chance to be the better us. They're our to her.